I do feel that I'm shining. As believers, from the first sight, from the first time you meet a believer, you know that you are eternal brothers or sisters. You know, because the one who joins us is eternal. It's Jesus and His blood that join us together. Our message is taken from the book of Luke again. You may imagine that I do love the book of Luke. I love the whole Bible. Those who know me know that I love from the New Testament the writings of John and Isaiah in the Old Testament. But you know what? I shouldn't mention this. I love the whole Word of God. I think the Lord led me to these passages or stories from the book of Luke, Gospel of Luke, to share these stories and sermons with you. So today, I'll read from Luke 14. And it's a long passage that I will read, but I won't read it just in one shot. I will read one passage after the other as I preach. Starting with verse 1. And it came about when he went into the house of one of the leaders of the Pharisees, and that was on the Sabbath, to eat bread. So it came about when he went to that house that they were watching him closely. And there, in front of him, was a certain man suffering from dropsy. And Jesus answered and spoke to the lawyers and Pharisees, saying, "Is it lawful to heal on the Sabbath or not?" But they kept silent. And he took hold of him and healed him and sent him away. And he said to them, "Which one of you shall have a son or an ox fall into a well and will not immediately pull him out on a Sabbath day?" And they could make no reply to this. Amen. May the Lord bless our sermon, our passage, His word to our hearts this morning. So as I said, I'll be reading the other passages just as I preach. From the first part, this is the first part of my sermon. You know that Jesus was invited to a great house. Someone who was, I shouldn't use the word great according to my language, Arabic, when I used it once I was presenting a thesis to my teacher. He said to me, "You never use the word great for anything or anyone else but God." As you know, in Arabic, especially in Islam, God has 99 names. And one of the names is great, the great. So you don't put God's name on anything else or anyone else. The word great belongs to God and God alone. That's in Arabic. In Arabic is Azim, great. I know that we may use great in any other language for any other thing that you want to express great things about. So, yeah, this man, according to humans, was great, the Pharisee. It says, one of the leaders of the Pharisees. He was a great man. His house was great. The supper, or I believe the food was great. I mentioned the supper. You will know how I concluded that that was a supper. Did you read any word about supper or lunch or breakfast here? No. It says that he was invited to eat bread. You can eat bread at any time of the day, right? But you understand how I concluded this was a supper. I said I concluded. I didn't say I confirmed, right? So, this man, great man, in the eyes of humans, great house, great food, great invitation. And to make it all great, he decided to invite the great master, the great teacher, Jesus Christ, in those days. They heard about Jesus as truly, he was the great teacher, the one who performs all kinds of miracles. No one was like him, and everyone who would listen to him, he would be attached to Jesus. He would like to follow Jesus and listen to Jesus more and more and more. If you remember well in John chapter 1, when the Pharisees sent their disciples to listen to Jesus in order to catch him, to trap him, then he turned back to them and said, we didn't hear anyone like him. Same thing in John 11, after Jesus had raised Lazarus from the dead. It says that many of them believed in Jesus. This is why the Pharisees in John 12, they said, well, you know what? Let's not only kill Jesus, but let's kill also Lazarus, because he was a testimony, a living testimony of Jesus' miraculous power over death. So, yeah, Jesus was the great master, and this is why I put the title, The Great Supper with the Master. I should put the great master, but there is only one master, as Jesus said in John 23. People would call each other master or Abba or Father, but you have only one Father in heaven, and you have only one master, who is Jesus Christ. Amen? So he is the great master. I call him the master. Now, let me share with you a bit about the shape of the place. In those days, if it is a small invitation, you may have a long table, not like in the picture. You see, this picture is in long, you put it. In those days, they put it in large. So the hole was not in long, it would be in large. It's a big hole like this, and the table would be in large. So people would come in, they would see everything on the table. See? We do have some pictures of the Last Supper. Jesus with the disciples, you see it in large. So whosoever comes in, you can see everything on the table. So if it's a small invitation, you may have a large table. And invitees, guests and everyone would sit behind the table. And when it becomes bigger, the invitation is bigger, you cannot push the walls. What you do is, you go along just at the extremities of this large table. So at the end, you may have the shape of a U. You understand? So those servants would come in to the center of the U, where the main guest is sitting beside the owner of the house. And then from the most important, from the greatest one to the lesser, to the end of the U. Do you see what would be the shape of the table of the invitation? So the servants would come in and serve this way. Again, come into the center, give the biggest portion, the greatest food here. And as you reach the last end of the U, you may not have enough or the good thing to eat. So this is why people would run to sit where? In the middle or beside the middle. Don't go and sit at the last end because you may not eat what you would like to eat. So in this story, we read that Jesus was invited, and certainly he was sitting where? In the middle of the table, at the middle of the edge of the U, of the end of the U, reverse U, I should say. And then it says, look to the words. Look was very, I would say, tiny, or would put things in the right way. Why? Because he was a doctor. He would put the exact drop of the exact substance in order to make the medicine, right? As a doctor, physician in those days. So he would use the words exactly as they should be. It says, Jesus was invited to eat bread. They didn't invite him just to eat with him. It says, because they wanted to watch him closely. You may look at it positively, say, Pastor Patty, they wanted just to see what color his eyes were. I don't think so. I don't think so. They wanted to trap him. They wanted to see if he washed his hands or did exactly as the law teaches, so that they may trap him. They wanted to see, watch him closely. I'll go to it just in a second. It says, and there in front of him was a sick man. How come? Let me tell you, the Pharisees would not themselves come to an invitation if any one of them is sick. Because for them, sickness is a curse or something that you did wrong. This is why God has sent you a sickness or a problem in your life. So you don't come. And by the way, if any of the Pharisees would know about you, that you are sick, he will not invite you. Because he may bring your curse with you to his invitation. So all of them would feel themselves, we are clean, we are healed, no problem at all, we are perfect before God, and this is why we are accepted by God. That was their teaching. So it's impossible that they invited this sick man. And by the way, so that you may know, what's dropsy? It is a sickness that hits the stomach. You cannot, and it may show outside. You cannot eat if you have this sickness. I mean, if you're invited to watch TV, yeah, you may have a problem in your stomach and watch TV. You can see with your eyes. But if you're invited, if there is food, will you come? Knowing that you cannot eat? Why should you come? And by the way, this man, it doesn't say he entered from the main door and everybody watched him and said, hey, hello, and we invite you to come in. No, at all, not at all. It says, just like that, there, before him, in front of him, in the middle of the queue, someone who was sick came to Jesus directly. How could he come? It doesn't say. I don't know. Nobody knows. Maybe he entered with the servants. But he dared to come into this great man's house, the Pharisee, not taking care of or paying attention to any who would look at him and see he's sick. It shows on his skin. How come he came in? Let's go away. He is bringing his curse with him. We cannot sit with him. We cannot eat with him. They were scared, I'm telling you. He was before in front of Jesus. Look to the words. It says, and Jesus answered. Did you read with me? Let me ask you a question. Who asked him a question so that he may answer? There is no question asked here. See, the sick man was in front of Jesus and says, and Jesus answered. Answered which question? What question? It seems that they asked a question in their hearts, in their minds, and Jesus read what was in their hearts. He knew exactly what they are thinking about. May I share with you a short story about thinking about? It's a story about a German employee who worked in a port, and he had certainly a big accent, I think bigger than my accent in English. And suddenly he hears a cry on the microphone. He says, hey, sir, in the port, or the guard, whatever. He said, help us, help us, we're sinking, we're sinking. And the German, you know, employee said, okay, sir, I'm here to help. And the other side said, sir, we're sinking, we're sinking. And the German said, yeah, okay. What are you thinking about? These people were thinking of trapping Jesus, and especially as he will heal this sick man. He answered their hearts. He knew exactly what they were thinking about. And he said to them, is it lawful, is it according to the law to heal someone or not to heal someone? Is it good to do something good in the Sabbath or it's not? It says, they kept silent. What do you do usually when you keep silent? The easiest answer is you close your mouth, right? In order to keep silent, you don't open your mouth. Usually you open your mouth for one of two things, either to speak or to eat, right? So if you keep silent, you close your mouth. So Jesus at first closed their mouth so that they may not speak. I think also they may not eat. And he continued by saying, he took him, he healed him and said, you're healed, you can go free. And he said to them again, another one, who amongst you would not give help to an animal that falls in a pit or in a well on the Sabbath? All of you do it. And it says, and they could make no reply to this. What does it mean? They kept silent twice. Jesus shut their mouth twice. I think because he cannot sit with this kind of people and eat in peace. Jesus will not sit and eat in our house, in our life, if we do not follow and be walking in His ways. If we don't have the right way of thinking in Him and in others, how would you think that Jesus would live with you and sit with you on the table, at a table? Let me continue reading. Verse 7. And he began speaking a parable. You know, it was time to eat. It's time to eat, but Jesus was teaching. He was bringing them another kind of bread. He began speaking a parable to the invited guests when he noticed how they had been picking out the places of honor at the table. What are these places? In the middle, right? Beside Jesus and the owner of the house. And says, saying to them, when you are invited by someone to a wedding feast, do not take the place of honor, lest someone more distinguished than you may have been invited by him. Then he who invited you both shall come and say to you, give place to this man, and then in disgrace you proceed to occupy the last place. That's the end of the you. But when you are invited, go and recline at the last place, so that when the one who has invited you comes, he may say to you, hey friends, move up higher, then you will have honor in the sight of all who are at the table with you. For everyone who exalts himself shall be humbled, and he who humbles himself shall be exalted. What a principle. What a great teaching from the Master. You know, when you are what you are, when you reach a certain point in your life, either in your education or in your position in the society or at work or even in the family, you think yourself important. It's very dangerous when we reach and we get things, places, positions in the world, because pride may hit very fast the human heart. And remember the first sin? It wasn't Adam and Eve. It was the angel who wanted to be in the place of God. Read Isaiah 14 and Ezekiel 28. They both spoke about two kings, the king of Babylon and the king of Tyre. And right away, he goes from speaking to the humans, and you can see he's speaking to a cherub, and that's the angel, Lucifer, who fell and became Satan. The first sin was pride. And it says very clearly there that you corrupted your wisdom for the favor or because of your beauty. Let me explain this. Beauty is something good. It's not something bad. Okay? Don't miss. Beauty is something good. God is beautiful. Jesus is the wonderful, the beautiful of all. Wisdom also, certainly you know, is a good thing. But now, how can sin come into these two or three, these two? It is very important to put each one in the right place at the right time. I'll give you an example. You will always put your wisdom before your beauty. Let your wisdom walk you and make you decide, because your beauty may change. And I know we are speaking humanly, because our beauty will change with age, right? But wisdom should grow with age, should be better and more and greater with age. So wisdom should continue to be first, and beauty should come last, if not, I would say second, if not last, I should say. But when you go every morning and you look to the mirror and say, oh, how beautiful I am, you know what you do? You put your wisdom at the rear, and you put your beauty in front, and this is exactly what the angel did. Beauty is not wrong, wisdom is not wrong, but he said, oh, how beautiful, how wonderful I am, I'm more beautiful than God. He corrupted his wisdom, and sin started in him, and he fell and became the devil. Be careful when you think you got something more than others. These people thought they were very important, more important than others, and they would run and push so that they may sit in the place of honor. This is, I'm better than you, I'm greater than you, I'm more honorable than you. I wish we do this in churches. When I go to churches, usually as I see in your church, unfortunately I have to say, the front row is always empty. Why? I don't know. Let me tell you, when I accept Christ in my life, I would always sit in this on this spot. The front one, for two reasons. I don't want to see who is coming in, who is going out, but what she wears and what he did. I don't want to see anything. And second, I want to get every word from the pastor, catch it, keep it in my heart, take notes, and swallow the whole sermon. So I'm encouraging you to come next week and sit in the front row. I don't know why in churches people sit in the rear rows, you know. Without my glasses, I can't see them. See, why I'm encouraging you? I thank God for your church because it's enlarged. It's not too long. I preach in an afternoon in a long church. This morning I'm preaching in a large church. May the Lord enlarge your hearts, amen, and enlarge your building, and enlarge your minds and souls so that you may get the word of God, all of it. So, in churches, we should come first, we should be first, not to be first, I mean in pride, but first to take God's word, to obey God's word, to follow Jesus and be with him all the time. Unfortunately, these people wanted to boast and wanted to be filled by their pride and show that they are more important than others, and Jesus hit it on the nose. I know Jesus, he is true, he is real. He would say these words and look to the right and look to the left by saying, when you are invited to a wedding, you don't rush and push, you don't have to sit in the most honorable place, because the owner of the house would look at you and say, hey sir, I'm sorry, there is someone who is better than you, greater than you, more honorable than you, so go take the other place, the last place, so you will go in disgrace and do it. I think Jesus was looking to the people beside him. I do believe, because he wouldn't preach to people who were in the uttermost part of the earth, they don't hear him. He was preaching to people around him. And this is why many times the Pharisees knew that Jesus was speaking to them and about them, because he wouldn't say anything in their back. But in front of them, in order to heal them, in order to shake them, in order for them to repent, and unfortunately not many would repent when they hear the word of God. So Jesus was saying, and the principle here is, whosoever exalts himself shall be humbled, but the one who humbles himself shall be honored, shall be exalted. And I believe Jesus, in order for him to sit with you, or for you to sit with him, you should ask him to humble your heart, or ask him for humility or humbleness in your heart. Maybe ask the Lord this morning and say, Lord, make me humble. We don't know what humble or humility is. You know why? Because the best place or the best way to be humble is to return to the dust from where we came. And you know what? That's not humility. Because we are dust. We cannot go under. We cannot go lesser than this. You know who knew humbleness truly? It is God, Jesus. But once in the image of God, he decided to humble himself and become a human like us. Not only like us, he went to death. To the death of the cross. This is why the Father exalted him and gave him the name that is above all names, so that in the name of Jesus, every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is Lord for the glory of the Father. Say amen. Amen. We don't know what humbleness is. May we ask the Lord, teach me, Lord. He said in Matthew 11, 28, 29, he said, come to me, all you are burdened, and I'll give you rest. And he says right away, follow me, Lord. Humble yourself, for my yoke is easy, so that you may have rest in your souls. Ask Jesus to make you humble and meek like him. And he also went to sick. That's the third paragraph. He said to the one who had invited him, let me show you one thing before we continue. I think those who were at the main row, main place, the honorable place, as Jesus was saying to them, you should choose the last place, I think they were touched and they were, you know, very angry at Jesus. I think they left. They decided to go. They looked to the owner of the house and said, this is the great man you invited. He was talking about us and to us so that we don't sit beside you. Next time you don't invite us to him. I think this is what happened. Think with me, Jesus was speaking to them, the ones who came and took the higher place and said to them, you should sit in your last row, last place. I think they got angry and went away. I think so. You will know why I'm saying this. Then nobody left but the owner of the house. He turned to the owner of the house and said, when you give a luncheon or a dinner, do not invite your friends or your brothers or your relatives or your rich neighbors. The rich people, the Pharisees. I'm not saying the rich are bad, okay? Don't say, I said it to the rich. No, I'm saying, I know what he's talking about. Lest they also invite you in return and repayment come to you, or they will reward you. But when you give a reception, invite the poor, the crippled, the lame, the blind. And I think if there are any Pharisees there, they'll say, what? Can we sit with this kind of people and eat with them? They're cursed people. And Jesus said to him, and you will be blessed since they do not have the means to repay you. For you will be repaid at the resurrection of the righteous. Let me stop here. I think Jesus was saying a great teaching, or presenting a great teaching to the owner of the house. After teaching about humbleness or humility, he was looking at the man. I think he saw in him some good intention. He wanted to meet Jesus. He wanted his rich and religious people, friends, to meet Jesus. Unfortunately for those who got angry and left, I think. And I don't know if there were still some Pharisees. I think some Pharisees who were sitting by the end of the queue found empty spots and wanted to come in to eat better food. I think so. However, before filling these spots, Jesus addressed the word to the owner of the house by saying, hey, when you invite, don't invite these people. Those whom you know, those just who you expect to reward you, to invite you again to their houses. But invite those who are outside. Because these people, the lame, the poor, the crippled, the blind, the man who had dropsy, who got healed. Did you forget this man? What happened to him at the beginning of the story? It says that Jesus healed him and did what? Let him go. So he went. Where do you think he went, that sick man? Let me tell you. If you cook something very, very good, and the smell is very strong, and the smell of the good food gets out of the church, what do you think the people who are walking outside would do? First of all, they would smell. They would feel the good food that's inside. And at least, they would come to the window and say, what are they cooking? What are they eating? See, they would look and, it seems it's tasty. Let's try to come in. And they would try to come in. It's a church. Everybody is welcome, right? And the door should be always open. Our hearts should be always open. And people say, you have a good smell. You have a good food. And who's the cook here? We would like to meet him. We would like to eat with him. And they would come in. And you know what the believers would do? Would win them to Christ. About what food I'm talking. About what smell I'm talking. About what cook I'm talking. If your spiritual smell will go out to the neighborhood, people cannot but stop at the windows of the church and say, I smell something good coming out of your life. And I would like to taste it. I would like to have it. I would like to walk with you. And Jesus, I would like to be with you, with Jesus. I would like to sit with you. I would like to meet the cook, Jesus, and eat from his food and his bread. I think in that invitation, those cursed people in the human's eyes, not cursed in God's eyes, But according to the Pharisees,
they went outside smelling the food. They cannot come in. They're not able to come in. But as the man who had dropsy got healed and went out, I think he told his friends, hey, you know who's inside? There's Jesus. And I could see him and he touched me, he healed me. You know, we need healing. Let's try to come in as I could. I could come in, you can come in. Jesus receives us all. They would say, oh, but you know, this is a Pharisee's house and all, there are Pharisees, we cannot come in. They would curse us, they would push us out. And we would try to say to them, no, don't be afraid of people. Don't think of what they will say about you. Don't think of how they will look at you. Just think of Jesus. Come to this house and look in the eyes of Jesus. He will bless you. I think he said to the owner of the house, there are many people outside, crippled, poor, blind, all kinds of sicknesses, all kinds of problems. Go seek them. Go invite them. I think Jesus said to him, in order for you to be received in the resurrection of the righteous, you should have this kind of heart, the heart that receives everybody else. Didn't Jesus teach? The best and greatest commandment of all the law, the prophets, the Psalms is love your God from all your heart, and a similar one, and love your neighbor as you love yourself. If you don't have this heart, the heart that loves God, you cannot love your neighbor. And if you do truly love your neighbor, it's because you have the heart of God in you. In order to have the heart of God, the heart of Jesus, you have to receive Jesus into your heart, into your life. And when Jesus reigns and governs and lives in your heart, you will love your neighbor. You will invite them. You will seek their salvation. And if you hear something that rings in your heart, I would appreciate if you can say amen. You know, if you agree on something and you want it to happen in your heart, say amen. Say amen. I want it, Lord. I need it, Lord. Yes, I want to be revived. I want you to be alive in my heart. Otherwise, what kind of life am I living? Am I living only for myself? Am I just looking at what I benefit from? Can't I see there are needy people around me? Not only for the food, material food, but many people are dying without hope, without salvation, without a Savior. And they need us, and they call for us. Please, you have food, you have bread, you have Jesus. Can we smell Him? Can we taste Him? Can we see Him? Can we sit with Him? Or would you say, I'm happy with those whom I know, and we're happy as a family. I don't know what they are doing outside. Let them take care of themselves. Please don't do this. Don't say this. Jesus would always look at the lost, at the little, at the last, at the lonely. All starts with L. Then, and one of those who were reclining at the table, so it seems that there were still some Pharisees, that was one of them, with him, heard this. So when he heard a long sermon, I've been preaching for about 30 minutes now, a little bit less. So imagine Jesus was invited to eat, and they asked him to, give grace. Would you pray for 30 minutes? Come on. My pastor once told me, when his daughter was about 3-4 years old, they invited a pastor who came from the U.S. to Lebanon for dinner. And as they asked him to pray, well, it's a joke, it doesn't say, it's not literal. He said, he started praying from a book of Genesis and he ended with a revelation. And all the time, my daughter would say, amen, amen. She would say amen all the time as he prays because he prayed a long prayer. She wanted to eat. She wanted that prayer to end finally. I think those people thought that Jesus, well, you know, he was talking for 30 minutes. We want to eat finally. We came to eat. We asked him to say, in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, let's eat. But Jesus wanted to address a sermon. First point, second point, third point. And here, he doesn't stop. And as that man who wanted to eat was reclining, he was reclining at the table. Everyone wanted to eat, and Jesus said, no, we didn't finish. I have still a point. I tell you, he told the longest story in his sermon. So no one can eat before he finishes. Listen. He said, well, the first, the man said, blessed is everyone who shall eat bread in the kingdom of God. That is, well, you know, I don't know who will eat bread in the kingdom of God. Let us eat now. We need to eat now. We're not in the kingdom of God. That's how I see it. But Jesus said to him, you don't eat now. He said, and usually when someone speaks to you, you don't eat, you listen. That's protocol. That's, you know, you have to, and especially if it's a great master. He said, Jesus, a certain man was giving a what? A big dinner. So either Jesus was inviting to a luncheon or lunch, then it became a dinner because of the long sermon and the long things that he did. Or he was invited to a dinner which became a late dinner because he was certainly talking first. I think he took the present, the real picture. He said he was giving a big dinner and he invited many people. Many people were there. And at the dinner hour, he sent his slave to say to those who had been invited, come, for everything is ready now. But they all alike began to make excuses. Let me put you in the picture. Listen to me. Don't read. I'll read for you. First of all, who were invited? The Pharisees, right? But the Pharisees, when they heard the first point Jesus preach about, and second, certain, and third, they felt, you know, he was talking about them and to them, they felt angry and they wanted to leave. And it seems that some of them, if not many of them, already left. With excuses that are not real. They said, in these excuses, the first said, I have bought a piece of land, and I need to go out and look at it. Please consider me excused. What? Did you listen what he said? He bought a piece of land, and then after he had bought this piece of land, he's going to check it. Would you do this? Do you buy a car and then after you go and test it? Do you buy a land and later on you go and see if it's a good land? What an excuse! And moreover, what can you see at night? It's dinner time. It's in the evening. Usually you do it during the day, right? It's dinner time. You don't do this. This is an excuse that is not valid. God cannot accept this excuse. Look at the second one. And another one said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm going to try them out. Please consider me excused. He's worse than the first one. Well, the first one wanted just to look the land. This, I mean, would you buy, how many? 10 cows. Oxen is 2, okay? So it is 5 yoke of oxen, yoke is 2. 10 cows. And now you are going to try them? You should try them before. Maybe they're sick. Maybe they will be at the edge of dying. Maybe cannot take care of their yoke. And in the night, look at the third one. What an excuse. The third one said, and another one said, I have married a wife, and for that reason I cannot come. Why? What does your wife do to you? I mean, when someone marries someone, if you marry a wife, come with your wife. It's a reception. It is a free reception. Jesus will not charge you anything. I remember in 1992, I celebrated, I was one of the people who celebrated a marriage, a wedding. You know what? It was on Saturday. The next day, Sunday, the married couple came and attended church. Hallelujah. God bless them. Because for them, they cannot take vacation from God. You know, next day is Sunday, so we should worship God. They came to church next morning. Or should say next afternoon, because church was afternoon. So if you got married, come with your wife. What is better than bringing your wife to see Jesus? To eat with Jesus. And to sit. And by the way, as I said, it's a free reception. That's not an excuse. You know what? Many times we share the gospel with people and they started
bringing all kinds of excuses. I remember some of them once said to me, Fadi, all what you say is great. I wish I can be like you. But you know, I know what? You said, I'm like you. We're sinners. And we deserve help, all of us. Jesus is saying, come to me and I'll save you. I mean, how long you need to think about this sign and come to Jesus? That's all what you need. Jesus is calling you. His grace is sufficient. He can save you. He can change you. He can make you his guest. Another one said to me, you know, Fadi, a relative of mine, said, well, I have a great position in the government and I cannot but lie. How can I follow Jesus if I lie every day? Said, you know what? I have an example for you. He was a captain in the government. I mean, not in the army, but in the government. Commissioner. I said to him, there is a story about a captain of 100 soldiers. He came to Jesus and he accepted Jesus and received Jesus in his heart. He became a believer. You can be like him. I witnessed to him many, many years. And every time I go to Lebanon, I witness to him. And he's still waiting. Waiting for what? All kinds of excuses. But Jesus is the same, calling every sinner, come to me, I'll make you new, clean, holy. However, these people left, they are empty spots. What did Jesus say? And the slave came back and reported this to his master. Then, I think one of the disciples of Jesus went to follow these Pharisees and say to them, hey, Jesus is calling you back. Come in. They gave all kinds of excuses. No. We cannot come in and sit with your master. He was talking about us and to us. We are angry. We don't sit with him. They gave all kinds of excuses. So one of his disciples came to Jesus and said, well, we didn't want to hear. This is what happened. Then the head of the household, and I believe that this time the owner of the house didn't have any power. He looked around and said, I mean, everything is destroyed. All the guests are gone. I don't know what's happened to my invitation. So Jesus took over. He became the owner. He is the owner of the whole universe. He is the owner of the household. He is the owner of your life. He is the one who commands. Amen. And he said to his slave or to his disciple, certainly that was a holy anger. He said to him, go out at once into the streets and the lanes of the city and bring in here the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame. Those who were outside smelling the food, let them come in. And I want to sit and eat with them. If the former owner of the house did not invite them, I invite them to come in. Then, and the slave said, Master, what you commanded had been done, and there is still room. You see how many Pharisees left the place? All of them, almost. And there are many rooms, many spots, many chairs, many seats. And the master said to the slave or to the disciple, go out in the highways and along the hedges and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. For I tell you, none of those men, the first, who were invited shall taste of my dinner. Jesus is calling all of those who know and feel they need Jesus. If you truly feel you need the Lord in your inner life, to heal your body, maybe at the first point, or to heal you from any kind of pride, or any kind of customs or things that you do in life, you only invite those who you know they will invite you. Instead of having this heart of God, loving everyone and whosoever they are, and then not expecting to eat right away, but to give thanks to God, and spend the time with the Lord first, eat his spiritual food first, and then you will have time to eat the bread. If you do need Jesus to enter into your life, into your relationships, into your marital life, between you couples, between you and your children, maybe between you and your neighbors, with whom you don't witness to whom, or with whom you don't have any relationship, with your people that you work with, your boss, you know, brethren, let me share this with you and I'll close. I was 19 years old when I started working in the bank in Lebanon. I worked for 10 years.
Believe me, from the first day I entered that place, I was like a believer for less than 2 years at that time. I prayed in my heart and said, Lord, please give me these souls. I would like to witness to them. When I say give me these souls, I say, I mean, okay, don't misunderstand me. This is how I say it in Arabic. I just did it right away in my heart. This means, help me to win these souls to eternal happiness with you. This is what give me these souls. You don't understand in English. Does it mean the same in English? Give me these souls? Okay, I thought it means kill them. No, I didn't mean that. I didn't mean that. Give me these souls, save these souls from eternal hell, and save them to your eternal happiness. That's what I meant. And you know what? I said, Lord, this young man, and I started praying for them and witness to them each and every day. You know what happened? The third one, I don't want to mention everything about him. He is now the pastor of the First Baptist Church in Beirut. I don't want to share with you how it happened. It's a long story. I shared a bit about it before. The second one, I didn't hear about him a lot. But about 5 years ago, an old man, he passed away just recently, who used to attend our church in Saint Laurent. He leaves me a message on the phone saying, hello, Pastor Paddy. I was in that town. I know that town. He said, you know what? Who I found there in the church? Such and such, the one with whom you worked in the bank, he is there in the church, and he said, please greet Pastor Paddy for me. He is the second one I prayed for. He is in the Baptist church there in that town. God answers prayers. You want the first one? That's the third one in my story. I went to Lebanon in 2010. He was sick with cancer. He was still in the bank. He returned back after chemotherapy. And I said to the ladies, what happened to him? They said, well, he has cancer. I called him aside. I said, hey, I'm mentioning his name. He said, you need Jesus. Take your Jesus to your heart. And I presented a grateful message of salvation to him. Enough for him to accept Christ. I don't know what happened after, because I came to Canada. I hope he gave his life to Jesus. Just a small, short story of if you decide to bring the lame, the blind, the poor, those who are in need of Jesus, God will grant you the desire of your heart. Because this desire of your heart goes along with the desire of his heart. Because the Son of Man came from heaven to earth to what? To seek and save the lost. And this is exactly what we should do. He said to his disciples, of his slave, I cannot eat with those who are different than this. I cannot eat with those who are proud or boasting. I cannot eat with those who look only to temporary things. I cannot eat with all of these people. But I can eat with you if you humble yourself. If you come to me as you are, and I can save you and change you, I can eat with you. And I think the supper started at that time exactly. When Jesus finished his sermon, all of those who meet Jesus came in. They were very happy, blessed, not cursed. I hope that the former owner of the house got saved. And the next time he invited people, he invited those who are in need. Amen.
Amen.
Let's all stand up for a word of prayer. These stories are alive stories. They are not only words written on paper. Jesus is alive, and he makes his teaching, his words, his stories alive in our days. Jesus would like us to be changed by the power of his Spirit. Would like us first to be cleansed, clean, by the power of his blood, to change our heart, to give us a heart like the heart of God, that feels, that loves, that cares, that forgives, that receives and accepts others as they are. He would like us to walk with him because he is meek and humble. He would like us to be like him. He is just and holy at the same time. And he would like us to serve him and do exactly as he did. He came to seek and save the lost. He would like us to be like him, but to seek, to find. There is someone lost somewhere out there. Go and find them and bring them to Jesus. They'll be healed. They'll be free. They'll invite others. They'll taste Jesus. They will sit with Jesus at his table. They will eat from the supper of the Lamb. This is the eternal supper. It starts, but it doesn't have any end. Brother Carlton, again, I would like you to come in. Come here, please. And close the word of prayer.
Great and merciful God, Father, what we've heard today, O Lord, just spur us to action. Father God, we need not take our salvation for granted. Many do not know you. Many keep you out of their lives, O Lord. Father, our witness, our salvation, should be readily seen by others. Help us, O Lord God, to have the fragrance of Christ so that others will be attracted, that will ask us questions, inquiring of us what is different about us in our workplace, in our schooling, wherever we find ourselves. May we be a living testimony to those around us. May we be a blessing to you, Lord, to keep our eyes focused on you. We have no power within ourselves. You are the one that gives us power, Lord. You are the one that gives us boldness and courage and the love to witness to others. Father, we thank you, Lord, that we have not been cast away. You have chosen us. And that choice is always with a purpose. May we not discard that purpose, O Lord. Praise to your name, Father God. Let us sing our benediction, those our servants. Say now unto him.